All right, one of the good news, at least, coming out, even if inflation's remained at a nine-year high, is you are expecting foreign direct investments to exceed $10 billion after the president has signed Executive Order 65. Am I correct?
That's correct.
And also the easing of restrictions following the newly signed agreement, I presume, coming from the 11th foreign investment negative list.
That's correct.
All right, explain the change.
Well, we are now on the 11th foreign investment negative list, FINL.
Yeah.
In the previous administration, there was hardly any change in the FINL. From President Arroyo to President Aquino, there was hardly any change. This time we have some substantive changes, not enough, but you know, at least you know, this will have some impact. And so several
let's discuss, because it's essentially easing restrictions on foreign direct investors.
That's correct.
Okay, what's been eased?
Okay, first is the internet business. But internet business here is not the media, like, you know, a media that sends messages.
Yeah. Also, I want to ask you directly, what about Rappler? It's a social media company.
It's not covered by that definition of internet business.
Okay.
Internet business is essentially refers to a business that carries messages. Doesn't make messages, but carries. It's a courier of business, of messages. Simply courier of messages.
Like what they mean, Google?
Well,
such a, when you say internet business, so, because like, the internet businesses are so big. Okay, I want to ask you, there's Shopee, Lazada, all these shop online businesses with the recently signed EO 65 and this FINL, does that mean? Because it means essentially you can be 100% foreign owned.
That's correct.
All right.
Yeah.
So what kind of internet businesses now in the Philippines can be foreign owned?
Well, I think Lazada and
Shopee. I've interviewed them. I'm not familiar with the ownership breakdown.
They are in the business of giving, of marketing, right?
Okay.
So they are engaged in marketing, so that would not be covered. But you know, a carrier or courier of message firm would be covered under this internet business.
Do you have an example of one firm?
I was trying to figure out which one would. I think, for example, coffee shops that, you know, that through which you can get
coffee,
and then you know, get coffee shops that allow you to get messages from abroad, you know.
Oh, so, those kind of shops.
Shops, yeah.
And you mean like literally an internet shop?
Internet shop,
yeah.
An internet firm that is a channel of messages.
Okay. All right. Well, I think I'll give you
news.
Time. Let me give you time to essentially break that down later on. All right. It also says that when it comes to teaching.
Yes.
Okay. Under EO 65, 100% foreign participation is, for example, in teaching.
Yes.
Which part of teaching are you allowing?
Teaching at higher education levels, on subjects or courses that are not covered by bar or board exams.
Uh-oh. Okay.
For example, law would not, you know, would be out of this teaching profession, and also accounting.
But essentially a school. Are you allowing schools to be 100% foreign owned?
No. The teaching in schools, foreigners.
Teaching.
Before the easing of this particular item in the FINL, even dual citizen, Filipino-American citizens, could not be given a teaching item at UP or any university in the Philippines.
So now you can have a British...
You can have.
You can have someone not, British not just, teaching you.
Not just dual citizen, but even fully
foreigner.
Foreigner.
Okay. All right.
The importance of this, Karen, is that there are so many high-level engineers and scientists who can really improve our teaching science and engineering
and math
technology.
And
math.
Okay. Although that won't have a dramatic effect on foreign direct investments immediately, but I understand what you mean. There's an influx of new knowledge coming
That's
in.
That's correct.
Yeah. All right. Training centers. Okay. This is interesting because this is an actual investment.
Yeah.
Training centers engaged in short-term high-level skills. Mm-hmm. That don't form part of the formal education system can be 100% foreign owned.
Yes.
Okay. What kind of training centers are these?
For example, TESDA is a training center.
Okay.
It's not part of the hierarchy, educational formal education hierarchy. They would be able to, you know, come in and set up a firm, a training center that trains people in robotics or in, you know, disruptive technologies, artificial intelligence, big data, and that would be really good for us because we need those kinds of skilled people. Yeah. You know,
I'm curious, under the EO, is it specific the industries where the you'd want 100% owned training centers, or it's just open except for
open?
Except for, okay.
Yeah.
Ang except for lang kasi basta it does not form
part of the
formal education system. All right, here's another one.
But you know, I really find that still restrictive.
Okay.
Because the supreme irony is that Vietnam, China, which used to be, you know, centrally planned economies, even now they're still, they're able to, you know,
have schools.
Set up schools.
Yeah, that are 100% foreign-owned.
Universities, either in conjunction with a local university or even a separate university. For example, you have a Stanford University in Singapore, or, you know, in association with another university.
And that would actually,
We should really have that.
Okay, I'm curious, did you fight for that?
We did, but then it's not allowed under the law. Law would have to be revised.
So it's a congressional...
It's a legislation, it's a law...
But law would you need charter change for that or just an amendment?
It has to be legislated.
Like some, a change some, in some the charter?
Are, some are prohibited by the constitution, others are prohibited by the laws of the country, you know. So those things cannot be eased by an executive order.
Okay.
The ones we were successful in having eased are those that can be done through an executive order.
Okay, I'm curious what was the hindrance to, let's say, having mass media. I mean, you're already watching cable with so many, or even other industries now.
Yes, yeah.
Pero ang mining natin ba may 100% foreign owned?
Mining.
Maybe not. I'm not familiar. That's why I'm asking you.
I think mining is.
Okay. What about power?
But so far, there's still some local participation.
Oh, pero power.
Power. Well, that would be that is covered and that is a public utility.
Oh, so no.
It has to be.
Okay. Local. Are you in favor of those being completely foreign owned?
Yes.
Personally,
as an academic. Yes.
So the fears of foreigners taking over, you know, those are always the fears.
Yeah.
You don't have those fears.
Those foreigners cannot take out their investments here, you know.
What about telecom?
Telcos will be taken out of the definition of public utilities.
Okay. So ang telco,
it's a public service, but not a public utility.
Okay.
Only public when the Public Service Act is passed into law, then only water supply, electricity supply, and water and sewerage would be disallowed in terms of foreign participation. But telcos and other public service firms will be allowed.
Okay, but in terms of national security, is that an issue?
Well, there's national security is another aspect that prohibits the participation of foreigners.
Yeah. No, but I'm saying in terms of telco being completely foreign owned, is national security an issue with that for you?
No, it's not an issue.
Okay, all right. Here's another one. Okay, this one, I mean, it seems more logical. Adjustment companies, lending companies, finance companies, investment companies can now be 100% foreign owned.
Yes.
Okay, what would the change be in terms of FDIs?
Essentially, like the banking sector is, you know, they can be 100%.
But did you do an estimate how much money would come in if this was eased?
Well, that is hard to estimate because we don't know how many will be interested in coming over.
Yeah. Okay, and I didn't expect this to come in, but wellness centers.
Wellness centers.
Why do you think of
massage parlors and others that are, you know, not are going to be injurious to morals and the health of
injurious
Filipinos.
To morals.
Well, I mean, you know, questionable.
Okay. Now, I mean, you're right. It's a baby step. Executive Order 65 is a baby step for 100% ownership. Yeah. But I'll be honest.
Because in you know that in Vietnam, practically all areas and activities are 100%.
Meaning it's allowed.
Allowed foreign ownership, foreign participation.
Yeah, which is why actually you have a lot of Filipino businessmen that already go to Vietnam to seek business there.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. But given that these five areas aren't, I mean, they're not very big after we've discussed it. Mm-hmm. Why do you think will it play a big role in foreign direct investments coming in? You did say in the first 7 months of 2018, you have FDI inflows. It's already reached $6.7
billion. $6.7 billion, and that was an increase of 52% over last year's level in September, for 7 months. So even without the this 11th foreign investment negative list easing, we should already exceed last year's 10 billion.
Okay, when you speak with foreign investors, Secretary, what is their biggest issue? Why the Philippines, even if we are the fastest growing, why we aren't the first choice for foreign direct investments? You had Vietnam hitting $20 billion at 1 year, very dramatic. Mm-hmm. What is, I mean, based on your experience and conversation?
Retail trade is still controlled, you know, retail trade. We wanted to reduce the threshold. It's still only those below $2.5 billion are allowed. Above, we wanted to bring down the threshold to $200,000.
Yeah.
But, you know, that did not prosper. That did not pass.
Because of the fear it will compete with local retailers.
Yes. And but in the meantime, there's a Retail Trade Liberalization Act pending in Congress. When that is passed, then, you know, retail trade will be liberalized.
Okay.
Considerably.
Okay.
Yeah, that's important.
That's important. Yeah.